have Moumita Dutta as our guest speaker. Moumita Dutta obtained her M.Tech degree in Applied Science from the University of Calcutta. She joined the Space Application Center, ISRO, Ahmedabad, in 2006. She has been involved in many prestigious projects like the Ocean Sat, the Source Sat, Hyperspectral Imaging Satellite, Chandrayaan 1, to name a few. She is one of the top ISRO scientists and was a part of the team that worked on India's first interplanetary mission, Mangalyaan, or the mission orbiter Mars. Mars orbiter mission. As a project manager for the maintenance center for Mars, she was responsible for the developing of optical system of the Mars mission. Her research area includes miniaturization of gas sensors, which involves state-of-the-art technologies in the field of optics, and is also leading a team in the development of optical sciences and working towards the realization of Make in India concept. Her talk today focuses on mission orbiter Mars, discusses the reasons and potentials of the mission, including the achievements, technological challenges, as well as potential technological spin-offs for the society. A recipient of the ISRO Team of Excellence Award for MOM, ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Srimati Moumita Dutta.
Very good evening to you all. It's a pleasure for me to come over here today and here today to share with you the exciting story of ISRO's mission to Mars. But before that, let's have a look into the very beginning of ISRO's venture to space. What was the start? So, this properly. So the incredible journey of ISRO started way back in 1963 with Dr. Vikram Sarabhai establishing the Indian National Committee of Space Research or INCOSPA. Indian space activity saw its first milestone with the INCOSPA growing into Indian Space Research Organization in 1969. So, but then it was not very easy task to convince the then Indian government to provide funding for India's space activity. Dr. Vikram Sarabhai did exactly the same. He convinced the then Indian government to provide funding for Indian space research. So, with the foundation of Indian Space Research Organization in 1969, India's space program saw a boost which it had never seen before. India's first sounding rocket was launched in 1961 from Tumba Equatorial Spaceport. Going back by 47 years, if you just give a glance to the then existing rocket technology of those days, you will be surprised to see how humble was the beginning. Just look at this picture of a rocket being carried in a bicycle. Or just give a look to the satellite called Apple being carried in a pull-up cart. From there, it has come a long, long way with much more improvised and superior rocket technology to build several indigenous launch vehicles. Pearson, the workhorse of ISRO, has put successfully many Indian and foreign satellites into the desired orbit. Also, India has made a remarkable progress in building geosynchronous launch vehicle or GSLV, which goes up to 36,000 km above in space and thereby re-establishing India as a superpower in world space industry. The first satellite of Indian Space Research Organization, Aryabhatta, was launched in 1975 by a Russian rocket. We didn't have our own launch vehicle that time. Aryabhatta provided India with a basic learning of satellite technology and the design. And after that, after a few years, Indian space technology again saw a chance with ISRO launching its first communication system, that is called SAI. Actually, it was a TV broadcasting program. The basic purpose of the program SAI was to provide proper education to the Indian mass, mostly in Indian villages. Then, in 1981, India created the first indigenous launch vehicle, SLV-3 or Satellite Launch Vehicle 3, put very successfully Rohini 1 satellite into the desired orbit after putting off from Sriharikota range of Andhra Pradesh. So this was the humble beginning of Indian space program. Today, India has its own ocean color monitoring camera, which monitors the ocean and it gives information to the fishermen for the availability of the fishes in the particular zones of ocean. Also, it has launched insect reading satellite and scatterometer, which gives weather forecasting, which gives very useful and valuable information about the forming of the cyclones so that mass can be protected from the natural calamity. And then, very recently, ISRO launched 104 satellites together. And many foreign countries now are approaching ISRO for launching their satellites. And then, ISRO now has its own GPS, own navigation system, that is called Gagan. And then, here you can see that the site satellite placed in a clean room, and here Dr. Sarabhai and Kalam discussing most probably important case about improving the rocket technology of India. Then, in 2008, ISRO launched its first lunar mission. Chandrayaan-1 took off from Sriharikota range of Andhra Pradesh on 22nd of October in 2008. The greatest discovery of Chandrayaan-1 was finding plenty of water molecules in the surface of Moon and also in the polar region. It was carrying 5 instruments, among which 2 instruments, hyperspectral imager and terrain mapping camera, was built by Space Application Center Ahmedabad. After the moon, Mars was the next terrestrial neighbor. But of course, the obvious question that comes to our mind, why to explore Mars? Well, Mars have similar thermal conducive environment and similar seasonal cycle like Earth. Like our mother Earth, Mars is also situated in the Goldilocks region, which is habitable. Also, it is believed that Mars had plenty of water and also a very thick atmosphere billions of years ago, when Earth was just a molten sphere. But over the years, Earth has evolved to a green planet full of lights, whereas Mars has lost all of its water and also part of its atmosphere. So, the obvious question that has always haunted our mind, whether life in any form do exist or ever existed in Mars. Also, we were eager to know whether the loss process of water and atmosphere can tell anything about the past of our Mother Earth, or it can predict anything about the future of the Earth. Here you can see a comparison between the parameters of Mars and Earth. You can see here the atmosphere atmosphere of Mars is mostly consisting of carbon dioxide, almost 95%. Thereby almost eliminating the idea of existence of life in Mars. But we find very small amount of methane existing in the Martian atmosphere, which can be an indicator of life existing in past, or it can be still existing. That is a question long asked and unanswered till now. Also, if you see size-wise, Mars is just half of Earth, and it is of 1.58 distance from the Sun. And if you see the length of the year, it is just double of Earth. And also, the surface temperature of the Mars is quite similar. Like the average temperature you will find there is -63°C. Here also in some of the region like Siachen and all, you will find the temperature of -50°C. Somewhere in the summer, it increases sometimes, and it has mostly similar, for some places of the Earth, most similar temperature cycle. So these are the reasons why we want to explore Mars. But the most important reason that I believe, it is a continuous drive among the scientists of the ISRO to overcome all the limitations to expand the horizon of space. It is a continuous quest, and also they wanted to inspire the future generation. Their motto was to set an example in front of the youth so that they consider very seriously the Indian space venture as a potential domain of revolutionary discoveries and greatest achievement. So, let us see. Now, I request you all to imagine that you went back 3-4 years ago in 2013. Let us just visualize that how this mission took shape. So, ISRO has many centers over the countries. One of the most important centers is Vikram Sarabhai Space Center, who prepares the launch vehicle. So let us see, way back in 2012 and 2013, what was happening in Vikram Sarabhai Space Center, that means in LPSC. If you see here you can see the PSLV-C25 rocket. They are building this rocket, which can carry a lift of mass of 320 tons, and the vehicle height is almost 44 meters. It has 4 stages. Here you can see the first stage assembly of this rocket. It's at the solid stage. And then in LPSC, the integration of the strap-on motors, the small boosters that you all see getting separated when the first stage separation happens. And then the integration of second stage. This is the rocket which carried the MOM satellite into space. And finally, the integration of third and fourth stage going on in LPSC. And then the center, ISRO Satellite Center, ISAC in Bangalore, it prepares the satellite. The all satellite subsystems are developed and gets integrated here. So what was happening there in Bangalore? If you have a look, you can see here the various subsystems of the satellite, like the communication system, the power system, the propulsion, that means the liquid engine motor, and also the another system called onboard autonomy or the onboard intelligence. Here you can see the subsystems like the propulsion system and the thermal system, some details are given here, and of course the antenna, the most important part for communication. So here is the primary structure for the spacecraft. It is just a bare structure, it's nothing integrated at present. And then the integration of propulsion system. Here you can see the fuel tank existing. And then here you can see the fuel tank getting integrated with the satellite, with the spacecraft. And here the liquid engines, the main engine, liquid apogee motor, accompanied by 8 small engines in the surroundings. And then this is the integration of various subsystems, also the solar panels. which generates the energy from the sun to keep the satellite going. And this is the internal structure of the spacecraft with all the subsystems integrated. Then, after VSSC and HAZAC, I come to my own center, Space Application Center in Ahmedabad. So let us see what was going on here at that time. Me with my team was building three instruments among the five instruments which were flown in Mars Orbiter mission. You can see here one by one the Mars color camera which took the first picture of the Mars. The first picture that you have seen in the newspaper was taken by this small camera. And then the medium sensor for Mars. Obviously, this sensor, this instrument is still looking into the Martian atmosphere in search of the methane. And then thermal infrared imaging spectrometer, which is supposed to map the thermal environment of Mars. Eventually, it is supposed to generate a thermal map over the global Martian surface. And then we have Lyman alpha photometer here. The purpose of sending Lyman alpha photometer is to find the water molecule still existing in Martian atmosphere. And then we have Menta. Menta is looking for the very high energy atomic particles in the upper atmosphere of the Mars. And recently it has made some great discoveries. So, what I would like to tell you that for the team which built the instruments, there were several challenges. We were given a very low budget of mass and power. All five instruments was to be built within a weight of 10 kg. The power budget was, of course, was very low. And the all instruments, like the whole mission, was to be built in a time frame of only 18 months. And all the instruments, let me tell you very frankly, was first of a kind. And we had nothing in our hand. No component, no electronics card, no harnesses, or no power system existing there. So what shall we do? One decision was taken that we will be developing the instrument with the cost component. That means we should be getting the components procured and then qualifying for the space and then build the whole instrument. Here you can have an idea. Here what you are seeing is the methane sensor for Mars. This is how the instrument looks like. This is the internal structure. I will not go into the details of this. Only thing I would like to say, the weight of this whole instrument which is looking for methane was less than 3 kg and it was consuming only 7.5 watt of power. These are the subsystems or these are the components for which we were running all through. This is the optical system, the lens which collects the energy. This is the sensor, the detector, which converts the optical energy to the electrical energy. This is the electronics which converts the analog signal to digital signal. And then after integrating all these subsystems, we get the whole instruments as a whole. And here we can see rigorous testing going on in Space Application Center. We have to give proper vibration to the instrument because when the launch vehicles take off, there is severe vibration. We have to ascertain that this instrument is capable of sustaining this kind of vibration. Also in space, there is no air. It is all vacuum. So we have to make sure that all components we are given here to build the instrument should be working in space properly. That means all the subsystems we are having should be qualified to work in vacuum. For that, you can see we have a small vacuum chamber here. We have even beakers, but for these instruments, this one is sufficient. So this was evacuated of air. An instrument was put there and switched on to see that all the performance of the instrument is normal. So, what I want to say that a team for these 18 months worked day and night to develop this kind of instruments, running for the components, then getting all the components integrated, then rigorous testing, and then final demonstration of the actual performance, an end-to-end development of instruments just in 18 months. But the team worked day and night and come up as per the expectation. So we were ready with the instrument and we could deliver all the instruments in time. This is the Mars color camera. I want to show you separately, particularly this camera. This was less than 1.5 kg of weight. Such a small camera went to Mars and giving the pictures at a distance of almost 80,000 km. So here you can see all these instruments, all the five instruments that I have shown, they are integrated on the satellite. What we do, we take these instruments to ISAT, integrate it with the satellite. And here I come to explain you the challenges of spacecraft. So, when a spacecraft crosses the Earth atmosphere and above that, to start its journey for Mars, what it goes through? It passes through a very harmful Van Allen radiation belt, which consists of charged particles like electrons, protons, and nucleons. So, when we send this satellite through this harmful belt of Van Allen radiation belt, we have to make sure the satellite is properly protected. Otherwise, this charged particle can damage all the subsystems, and this damage, this radiation level is good enough to jeopardize the whole system. So we have to suddenly protect this satellite from this kind of harmful radiation. Then another challenge is the thermal environment. Why? Because since Earth is closer to Sun, if you can say Earth phase is a hot case for the satellite, then the Martian phase is certainly a cold phase. The solar load on Mars, if you see the load, the heat load coming from Sun, that is almost 42% of that of the Earth. Also, in Earth, you don't find much variation of the solar flux. But due to the ellipticity of the Martian orbit for the particular shape, in Mars, you will find the solar flux varying almost to plus minus 19%. That means an average variation of flux of almost 40%. So all our subsystems should be equipped like that so that it can sustain this much variation of solar load. And then another challenge was power. You all know that the solar panel in the satellite generates the power from the solar energy. But the power generation in Martian orbit is only 50 to 35% of that in Earth orbit. That means if in Earth the solar panel generates 1 watt power, then in Mars it will generate only 0.35 watt power. So we have to keep in mind that particular aspect. Also, the solar cells, the operating temperature according to Martian atmosphere operates into 2 degrees centigrade to minus 20 degrees centigrade. In Earth, we never face that. When a satellite orbits around Earth, we never face this kind of low temperature. But in Mars, of course, we face that. So we have to take care of this kind of variation of power, this kind of lowering of energy, and equip our satellite with proper protection. So in the absence of solar panel, there will be the situation when solar panel will not be able to generate any energy. What to do that time? For that, backup batteries are provided. You can see here the 36Ah lithium-ion battery is equipped in the satellite so that in the exigency situation, that means when solar panel cannot work, it should produce proper amount of energy, and the backup batteries should keep the satellite going. In communication, generally we provide the Earth satellite with one or two antennas, but for Mars we have to provide the satellite with three antennas because we have to cover a distance of 650 million kilometers from Earth to Mars. Can you imagine in Earth when we launch a satellite, maximum with the GSLV rocket it goes up to 36,000 kilometers of height, but here we have to go to a distance of 650 million kilometers. So the first antenna, that is the Logan antenna, that can communicate only up to 1.4 million kilometers. The medium gain antenna up to 40 million kilometers. And the high gain antenna, it's more than 400 million kilometers. That means the 650 million kilometers of distance will be covered by high gain antenna only. And then here you can see a particular some testing going on here. That is the EMLEMC test. That means this test ensures that the satellite is protected from the harmful radiation. And then this is the thermal balance test. Since there will be power variation of plus minus 19% in Martian atmosphere, this satellite has to undergo this thermal balance test to check that this kind of solar load variation is okay for the satellite. And then this is the thermovacuum test. We have a large chamber, very large chamber of 32 meter diameter in ISAC. The whole satellite wrapped in the MLI blanket, the golden blanket to protect it from the radiation, goes inside this chamber, and this chamber is evacuated of air, and the satellite is switched on in the vacuum and all performances are tested. So this is how the thermovac testing of the satellite takes place. You can see the whole satellite going inside the thermovacuum chamber gradually, and after this the chamber will be closed. And here, after all testing, the satellite here is ready for shipment. Shipment to where? Shipment to Srikhalikota, where the launch vehicle is waiting for the satellite to be integrated on it. So here you can see the antenna is covered with a blanket, the whole satellite is covered. And here, the shipment to Shard is taking place, the flying off of the satellite. Here, the satellite we are taking out. We are taking the satellite out of its container in Shard. And then the pre-launch operations in Shard. Here, the spacecraft is integrated with the rocket. So here you can see the satellite placed over the rocket. And here you can see where it is. Can you identify where it is? It is on the fourth stage, just before the heat shields are getting closed. See, now the heat shields are closed. So it was just before closing of the heat shields. Just the satellite over the rocket. And after the heat shield is closed. So where you see, what you see in the videos, this portion, this fourth stage to be launched, and the satellite get, just the heat shields got separated and the satellite coming out of this. So now the mission challenge. So now we are in that time when our launch vehicle is ready. We have made all our instruments and that got integrated with the satellite. The satellite has undergone all kinds of testing like vibration, like thermovacuum, and the satellite is shipped to Srikhalikota, and there it got integrated with the launch vehicle and the heat shields are closed. So the rocket is ready for the launch. It is ready for its launch from Earth to Mars. But going to Mars is not a cakewalk. It is not an easy task at all. Why? Because for this kind of mission, a signal takes 40 minutes to travel to and fro. That means if I send a signal to the satellite telling a lamp to be on or an LED to be on, it will take 20 minutes to reach to Mars, and then the same signal to come back to us to tell, yes, the lamp is on. So 20 plus 20 to and fro, 40 minutes. Such a huge time delay. So to overcome this challenge, what we did, we equipped our satellite with a very special feature called onboard intelligence or onboard autonomy. That means while in contingency situation, while no communication from Earth to Mars is possible, that time the satellite will be able to handle or to execute all previously loaded command all by itself, but with highest precision and accuracy. Another major challenge was to design a trajectory which will take the satellite from Earth to Mars, but with minimum. We need to spend minimum fuel because we need to spend minimum money in this mission. So it was a very challenging task to design a trajectory, a path which will take the satellite from Earth to Mars with minimum fuel. Another major challenge was the time of the launch. This is because of a particular geometry formed between Earth Mars and Sun, which enables us to launch the satellite with minimum fuel. So, this particular geometry, that is a particular angle between Earth, Sun and Mars, happens once in every 26 months. That means, if we miss the launching window of 2030, the next window for launching will come again in 2016. So, we have to wait for 2.5 years or maybe 3 years. So, that is a long time. It will take resources, it will take money, it will take manpower to maintain the mission. And then, another important factor was, to launch with minimum fuel, the rocket should inject the satellite somewhere around the Earth in a particular orbit, but not over India, but over Pacific Ocean in Australia. But then we didn't have any ground station, any antenna to monitor this last stage of separation in Pacific Ocean. So we decided to employ two ships, Nalanda and Yamuna. It will take 2 months for the ships to go from India to the desired location of Pacific Ocean. The ships started here from India in time, but unfortunately it faced severe dust storm over Pacific Ocean. So the ships were delayed 5th of November 2013 and it very successfully put our satellite Mars orbiter mission or MOM satellite very successfully in the first parking orbit of the Earth, and that was the first milestone achieved by India towards the completion of this very successful mission. I would like to show you one video regarding this.
Finally, the solar panels were deployed for generation and supply of solar power to the spacecraft, followed by the deployment of the high-gain antenna, which will support deep space communication.
Our rocket put the satellite into the first parking orbit of the Earth. Remember, it's not in the Mars, but in the Earth. So the satellite is now rotating around the Earth. But to leave the Earth's sphere of influence or to leave the Earth's gravity, the satellite had to gain an escape velocity of 11.2 km per second. A very well thought trajectory and maneuver was planned to achieve this. If you see, the satellite was rotating around the Earth in an elliptical orbit. So every time the satellite was approaching the closest point of the Earth, that means the perigee, it was given a thrust, a sudden push by the liquid apogee motor or the main engine. It was fired, and every time the satellite was pushed into the next higher orbit and thereby progressively gaining its velocity. It took 7 such critical maneuvers to put the satellite into the highest orbit. So after the completion of the 7th maneuver, the satellite was in a position to gain 11.2 km per second. That means the escape velocity it needed to escape the Earth's gravitation or Earth's sphere of influence. So you can see here that the satellite was here orbiting the Earth, and then after it gained 11.2 km per second velocity, it was all set for its journey towards Mars. So the journey from Earth to Mars, the path of 650 million kilometers or the cruise phase was covered in a time of 300 days. It will be more clear in this animation. You can just have a look in this animation. Here the Earth appears and its orbit, and then the satellite. Here the Earth-bound maneuvers are taking place. You can see the one by one the elliptical orbits. That means the orbit raising maneuvers are taking place. And then, yes. And then the Mars appears here. And this is how the Mars orbit is placed. And from here, the satellite, after completing the 7th maneuver, the satellite starts moving. Yes, here. Here you can see the satellite is getting separated from Earth and it is approaching the Mars. So this green line, this green path is the cruise phase of 650 million kilometers, which was covered in 300 days or 10 months. But this cruise phase was a very vital period. The operations, it almost needed an error-free operation of 99.99%. Earlier, many missions of many other countries has failed just at this phase. So for us, it was a very critical period. And then, when on 30th November 2013, the satellite gained enough velocity, the escape velocity of 11.2 km per second, and it was all set to leave the Earth's surface and started its journey towards Mars. That was the second milestone achieved in this mission for ISRO. And then, after covering a distance of 650 million km in 10 months, it made its closest approach to Mars. Mars was almost, which indicated the correct start of the orbital sequence from the onboard computer. After 21 minutes, the liquid apogee motor, the main engine, started firing after a long silence of 300 days. Please remember that this engine, this main engine, was not operated for a single time over this 300 days of cruise phase. So when after 10 months, this engine got back to operation and we were able to operate it successfully, it was a moment of immense joy for all the ISRO scientists. But then, just after 4 minutes, all signal stopped. We were wondering what happened. What happened was, the satellite went behind the Mars. So the satellite was eclipsed by Mars. So no communication from Earth with the satellite was possible in this phase, because we are not able to see the antenna of the satellite. Also, the solar panel was no more generating any energy. So the backup batteries had to take up. So it was keeping the satellite going. But no communication was possible with the satellite. So what to do? For this contingency situation, as I have mentioned earlier, the satellite was equipped with the spatial system called onboard autonomy or onboard intelligence. So the satellite was able to handle all previously loaded commands with highest precision and accuracy in this time. To get captured into the Martian orbit, the velocity of the satellite was to be reduced from 5.1 kilometer per second to 4.1 kilometer per second. The liquid apogee motor was to be fired in the reverse direction to reduce the velocity. Because as you know that if we want a retardation, that means to decrease the velocity, we have to backfire in the, we have to reduce the velocity in the other direction. So the liquid apogee motor was to be reversed and fired in the other direction to reduce the velocity precisely. The whole operation took 26 minutes, this Mars orbit insertion. And these 26 minutes, what I remember, that in Mission Control Center, there was complete silence. I was observing this historical phenomenon sitting in an auditorium of Space Application Center, and I remember that the same silence prevailed in our auditorium also. We were eagerly waiting for a single signal to come back to Earth from the satellite, because we were not able to see the satellite. So we were glued to the screen and was expecting the one signal to come back again, so that we can say that yes, our satellite is performing perfectly. At 8 a.m. of IST, India created the history. Mom successfully entered the Martian orbit on 24th September 2014. So we couldn't believe that we became the part of a historical chapter to be written in the space history of India. A wave of joy and happiness spread all over the country. That is a moment of glory. Here you can see this is a very popular, and this picture is shown many times in many newspapers and also in many articles. All the ISRO ladies are cheering this joy. And then this is the payload team rejoicing the celebration. And then here is a picture of the Indian youth. I have never seen such a celebration of success. Here you can see the school children, they are standing with the Indian flag, and also here you can see the poster of the Indian space leaders holding. So here if we say, how precise was the mission? So according to Charles Ilaji, director of Jet Propulsion Laboratory, NASA, he told that if you go outside in Bangalore and hit a ball towards Los Angeles, the golf ball has to come straight into the cup, exactly to the hole. That's how accurate you have to come. And to make it a little bit more challenging, the hole is moving. That means it is almost in a golf ball from Bangalore to Los Angeles, it has to come directly in the cup. Such was the precision. Actually, I remembered Professor Lachi coming to Space Application Center and appreciating a lot. And then also he mentioned about this precision. Here, this is the first image. image of the Earth taken by Mars color camera where it was orbiting the Earth. And then we have certain glimpse of Martian surface taken by Mars color camera. Here is the Mangala Valleys, and then there is a Gale crater. Here you can see the famous crater where Curiosity landed earlier. And then this is the Valles Venerandis. These are the valleys which are extending for thousand kilometers over the Martian surfaces. And here this is the Edison Mons. And here you can see the very famous Ophir Chashma, the 3D image we have generated from the MCC image. This is the full globe image of the Mars taken by Mars color camera. And here this is the satellite. This is the satellite you can see. Yes, Mars has two satellites, Phobos and Deimos. Here you can see the CC has also imaged the picture of the Deimos. So this is the image of one of the satellite Deimos. And I think here, I don't know whether you are able to see, I have put a picture of the Phobos also. So here is the team in Space Application Center. This is not the mission team, this is the team in Space Application Center which made the instruments possible to be delivered over such a short period of time. Before going to the next slide, I would like to put a video of this Mars orbit inversion because the animation was not working. Just let me see whether. Here you can see how critical was the operation.
On September 24, 2014, the Mars orbiter spacecraft, after traveling 666 million kilometers, arrived at its destination in a hyperbolic orbit. And from here, the orbiter will be inserted into the elliptical orbit of Mars. Mars orbit insertion is a very critical maneuver, which will be carried out with a combined visibility of 70 meters ground and in, located at Canberra and Goldstone, and the onboard medium game antenna. It may be noted that Mars orbiter mission entered the sphere of influence of Mars on 22nd September 2014, and the final trajectory correction maneuver was carried out on the same day. Mars orbit insertion phase has demanded a large amount of preparation at spacecraft level. All the operations of Mars orbit insertion will be independently realized by the onboard processor by sequential execution of events without any ground intervention. The commands required for the same were loaded onto the satellite 9 to 10 days prior to this event, that is, on September 14 and 15, 2014. Mars orbit insertion operation starts with changeover to medium game antenna 3 hours prior to liquid engine burn start. This will be followed by forward maneuver 21 minutes prior to liquid engine burn, wherein the direction of satellite is changed and reoriented, pointing it to
the reverse maneuver,
so that the spacecraft velocity can be reduced by a desired amount. The spacecraft is held in the same configuration for some duration. Star sensors updates are enabled after forward maneuver. 5 minutes, 13 seconds prior to burn start time, the satellite is eclipsed by Mars, and hence the solar panels are unable to generate power as the sunlight is obstructed by Mars and doesn't meet. In this case, the onboard lithium-ion 36 ampere hours batteries will provide the requisite power by the spacecraft. However, the spacecraft is still in the line of sight of Earth and will receive data from it. Thus, 5 minutes, 13 seconds into intervals, actual burn start event will occur. The criticality of Mars orbit insertion burn lies in the fact that the orbiter should get captured without crashing into Mars or without leaking pumps. The liquid apogee motor is fired to slow down the orbiter's relative speed to the planet by 1,105 meters per second and a velocity from 5.1 kilometers per second to 4.3 kilometers per second in relation to Mars. Getting anywhere between 200 kilometers and 11,000 kilometers will keep the orbiter in the Martian orbit. Nearly 4 minutes 20 seconds after the Earth star, Mars outer stars. That is, the Mars orbiter will go behind the planet. As a result, no signal from the satellite will reach Earth for a considerable amount of time. Nearly 20 minutes past the Earth star time, the orbiter is likely to come out of eclipse. And though the solar panels will start to receive the sunlight, it will continue to be operated on battery power. This is because the satellite is still not in the line of sight of Earth, and hence the switchover is not performed. The total duration of Earth time is expected to be around 24 minutes. The satellite will come out from behind the Mars approximately 28 minutes after Earth star. And that's when the occult will end and the satellite will once again be in the line of sight of Earth. The power generation from solar panel and telemetry will be resumed nearly 2.5 minutes after the end of Earth, and data on Doppler measurement from the satellite is received, which will give the first information on the total Earth performance. The reverse maneuver, wherein the satellite is once again reach-oriented, pointing the high beam antenna towards Earth, starts 1.5 minutes to nearly 23 minutes after the end of liquid heat. The reverse maneuver ends nearly 11 minutes after the end of Earth, with the resumption of high gain antenna support. The Mars orbit insertion is completed. Thereafter, in the next 2 hours, the health parameters of the spacecraft will be verified, and the sequential operationalization of its 5 payloads.
We can stop here. And so what you are seeing here is the most critical operation of the whole mission. When the satellite was just behind the Mars and we were not able to see it, the last maneuver, reverse maneuver, or coming back to the path again, that time the satellite was visible from the Earth. So it was easy to complete the task. But when it was behind Mars, practically no communication was possible. That time our satellite handled all commands by itself with the onboard intelligence system. So you can see how vital it is and how accurate it has to be. Because as I told, a single error in executing a single command could have jeopardized the mission. So such critical it was. So as I was telling you, that this is the team in Space Application Center who made all the instruments. And then let us see that this is, let me tell you one thing, that this Mars orbiter mission, it is the first, the India has, this is the only country who has made it at its first attempt. This is the most economic interplanetary mission ever happened in the world. The total budget of this mission was only 450 crore, which equals to the expenditure of 82 movies in Bollywood. And then, if you go into further details, and if you calculate the expenditure per kilometer, then you will find that expenditure per kilometer is even lesser than the operation fare. So such an economic mission it was. Also, a very young team of average age of 25 to 30 years worked dedicatedly day and night to accomplish this mission. Women, 20% of the team was women. So here in this mission, not in this mission, but in every mission, the women scientists present in ISRO, they are working shoulder to shoulder with the men, leaving behind all other aspects of their family and life. And here we can see the quotes from some of the scientists of ISRO, that Ritu Karimhal told that in ISRO it is not about men or women. It's about who can give a solution to the problem. Or like we are learning, has told that when we are in Afron, we all are same. We forget about the gender. And what I personally think that when I think that I am doing something for my country which will benefit my country, I think all sacrifice is worth it. And this is what our director, Mr. Dutta, Mr. feels, that no challenge is faithful if the people of the country help and support us. And the same view is shared also by the team leader of the Pickles, Shobhna Sarkar, which he feels that if we want to do, really want to do something, then the whole universe actually will make it happen. And then I want to end my talk with the quote of Kalam sir, who told that dreams is not what you see in sleep, but this is the thing which does not let you sleep. So we all are working with this vision. With this, I come to the end of my talk. Thank you very much for your patience and valuable presence.